You know, everyone says they love games, right? And you know, I don't question that. But I'm the kind of person who loves games to a degree where people who say they love games tell me to shut up. I would go to a friend's house with like a box of all my games, right? And I would actually sit down and I'd watch them play, and I'd take mental notes about what they were doing and what they weren't doing and what they liked and didn't like. And I was always trying to figure out how to, you know, tweak things and what I would do if I was designing the game myself.
Working from home and making this whole family thing happen, like, you know, we take the good with the bad, and there were definitely points that were low points for us. When everything looked like it was, you know, at rock bottom, it was so scary. You know, I mean, we have four children in a house, and all our eggs are in this one basket.
Think about when you're the first time you're on the diving board, you know, you're about to jump in, and there's that fear, that exhilaration. You make that jump. It's the best thing you could have done. So for me, it was always about Zelda. Zelda was the thing that really sparked my imagination, and I was always drawing maps and just walking around in that world. Just the sort of the promise of anything being possible, and the sense of discovery and the sense of awe of just exploring that world and feeling like there's a rich history there, and you never know what's around the next corner or under the next boulder. That was always my number one, but I love them all. I play everything. A lot of times you talk to gamers and they say like, oh, I play everything but, you know, sports or everything but racing games, and I play everything. There's a passion that I have just about not only the experience, the fun, but I'm just enamored with the magic of like literally controlling something on a screen. Like every time I play a game, I'm always trying to figure out how it was made and what makes it tick, and sort of the design elements of it. But then also, like, I just can't get past the fact that it's magic, you know? And so I'm always, I think I look at them a little differently than most. At least I try to, anyway. At one point when I was 10 years old, I actually sent a design document to Nintendo. It was a pitch doc for Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. And, you know, being 10 years old, I didn't know what I was doing, and it was terrible, but they were kind enough to send me a reply from the Nintendo Fun Club, and it said, you know, Dear BG, you know, that was my nickname, by the way, BG, thanks for your ideas. You'll be pleased to know that the game you pitched us, Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, is being made by Mindscape, and you can contact them here and all that sort of stuff. And so what that was really saying is, hey, your idea, you'll be pleased to know that there's another company who's doing exactly what you're talking about. But being 10 years old, I took that to mean like, hey, we love your idea, kid. We're gonna make your game. And so, you know, I at one point I had a really awkward phone call, like being like, do you know who I am, to Nintendo? I was trying to figure out like get the release date and all that sort of thing. But anyway, so I was completely enamored with the idea of creating games. And so I sent in concepts for Metroid 2 and all. I just did that for years and years. And my parents owned a video store growing up as well. And so I was in charge of what games they would order to rent out, and you know, then eventually becoming obsessed with games my entire life, eventually found my way to film school, because at the time, you know, I wanted to make games, but games weren't really done in the West anymore. There was this period where it was completely dominated by Japan. And so to become a game designer or a game developer, it was like, oh, I guess I have to move to Japan. So my other passion was film. And so I wound up going to film school and went over to Universal Studios, worked for a company that eventually did Terminator 3. And I learned quite a bit, but, you know, I probably didn't learn as much as I should, because I developed a really unhealthy addiction to Diablo 2. And so, but that made me aware all of a sudden that, you know, development had shifted, and all of a sudden you had all kinds of games and studios opening up in the West, in the US. And so I said, you know what, I love film, I'm passionate about film, but games are really where I want to be. And so I moved back home and took up my old college job at Electronics Boutique. And for what I remember, for whatever reason, all the local developers came to this one store. You had people from Papyrus and Stainless Steel and Rockstar and Irrational Games. And so I was lucky enough to meet Ken Levine, the creative director at Irrational, and I somehow impressed him enough that he offered me an interview for a QA position, and got my foot in the door that way, worked my way up, into design eventually, and then lead level designer, lead designer, design director, you name it. So, it's just my life's passion. Take a look around, you know, get nerd stuff everywhere, right?
All right. Well, I mean, I've been a gamer pretty much my whole life. When I was a kid, we had this just awful old clunky computer where I would play King's Quest II, and so I was a gamer since I was a little kid. But I didn't formally get into the industry until Perception. So Bill and I are married. We've been together for 17 years now. And one of our first conversations was like, hey, I heard the PlayStation 2 is going to be backward compatible. So we've always been, you know, talking about games and whatnot. But he was the industry guy. I was an English teacher. So I taught high school English in my hometown of Linfield for like 12 years. And I also write books. So Bill and I have been collaborating professionally forever. So he would edit my books. And when he was working on BioShock and BioShock Infinite, he would come home and we would sort of go over story stuff, and I would help him, he would help me. I named Vigors. I was the one who came up with the word Vigors, so that's literally my only video game claim to fame before Perception, is that Bill was talking like, oh, we're gonna have this thing, it's gonna do this, we need a name for it, and I was like, Vigors. So that's it for games, other than being an avid gamer myself. And then Perception came along, and that's where my gaming career began. I always was playing games, even though nobody else in my family did. It was really nice. Like, my dad always had a system for us, so we had an NES. And, you know, my brother and sister would play some NES, but I was really, really into the NES. And then we got a Sega Genesis, and actually, we even had, we used to have a lake house on Winnipesaukee, and we had an old Atari there. So, yeah, I've always been a gamer. Even in high school, you know, I was playing RPGs, and I was playing PC games. So yeah, in college I played way too much Diablo 2, same as Bill. But yeah, I've played games since I was a very young child.
Do you remember your very first game?
It was King's Quest 2. And I remember it was pretty much just like, go left, go right, go straight, and like something would happen. I remember I would always go left and I was always get eaten by a wolf, and it was really frustrating, but I kept playing. I stuck it out. I eventually figured out, don't go left. And that was really formative for me. We went to high school together, but we didn't really know each other. We knew of each other. We both went to Linfield High School. It's really small, small school. And our sisters were friends. But we didn't really talk much. But
we had hung out a couple of times, but it wasn't until I was in college. Actually, I was out of college. And so she was her senior year in college. No, what?
You were in college because you went to California.
This is correct. Yes. You know, the history, right? It was the year 2000. I know that. It's pretty easy to remember, right? No. So yeah, absolutely. So I was in college.
He was working at Electronics Boutique, which is now GameStop, and I was working at Rainforest Cafe. Super cool. Had like the little Ranger Joe uniforms on, and it was in the same mall. And one day, my sister, who, I mean, she was like my, you know, annoying high school sister, and I was in college. And one day she was like, hey, can you drop my book bag off at Lindsay's house, which is where he lived? And so I was like, yeah, sure, whatever. I had my disgusting, like, Ranger Joe uniform on. I had, like, pot roast spilled on it. So I had no, like, I wasn't like, yeah, I'm looking fly, whatever. So I go over there. I go to drop off the book bag, and he opened the door, and I was like, oh, I remember you from high school. Hi. And I'm like, I smell like pot roast. But like, he was super nice. Like, I came inside, we ended up chatting, we all ended up going out to this restaurant, and like, we had a really, really great night. And we did talk a lot about video games. And 3 weeks after we started dating, Bill headed cross country to do his internship in Hollywood, LA. And I was back home and I went to UNH. And so this was like before really the internet enabled a whole lot, and you still had like called from a landline, that kind of thing. So what we would do is we sort of like played Diablo 2, and we both were playing Final Fantasy 8 a lot, and I understood it better than he did. So I remember this one time, I think I like got him a paid phone card or whatever, and I called him and I walked him through how to do the junctioning system in the game, and like we had this like 3 hour like long like I was playing my Final Fantasy VIII, he was playing his, and we spent all this time sort of talking about that game. And that game actually has a really special place in our hearts because that's the game we played when we first started dating. And the character, the couple in the game is Squall and Rinoa. And Rinoa, I had like the same haircut as her, and Squall, he had, I mean, like, Final Fantasy characters have that mad anime hair. I mean, his hair was similar, but we were always kind of like, oh, we're Squall and Rinoa, blah, blah, blah. And then fast forward, 17 years, we have our first daughter and we name her Rinoa. I could dig this up, but there was, hold on. Oh my God. Okay, so wait, let me just rewind. So he gets back from California and my college had a dance. And there's this one scene in Final Fantasy VIII where Squall and Rinoa go to this fancy dance and she's wearing this gold dress. Well, I did some digging and I found a gold dress that was really, really similar. So he shows up, I'm wearing like the Rinoa dress from Final Fantasy, and we went off to this, dance together, and the picture's right there. So his hair is quite tame. It is not very Squall at all. I think it's because we went to a fancy event. Sorry, this is very dusty. And the frame says groovy guy. We are so cool. So here's the picture. You can see my very long dark brown hair with my gold dress as Rinoa. It's funny, like we went to high school together, and like, you know, a few years after we started dating, we'd see people from high school. They'd be like, wait, you guys are together? So our sisters, you know, they thought it would be hilarious to set us up, but the joke's on them, because then we got married and had a bunch of kids, and now they're aunties to the same children.
It's not only that we share the same passions for gaming and storytelling, but it's also that I think we have a lot of the same approach to, you know, the philosophies in life, the sort of approach to problems. And all the stuff that we do together, making the Deep End games and making Perception, you know, I don't see how that's possible unless you have someone that you're really compatible with, not only emotionally, but just like how you deal with challenge, how you deal with the inevitable a million hurdles of indie development or raising a family. And so I think in the back of my mind, I always wanted to work together. We did always collaborate. You know, I would come home from Irrational, working on Fort Frolic or, you know, Medical Pavilion, and I would describe a scene. Like, I'm working on this one sequence, and you come into this back room with this doctor's office. It's actually a morgue, and you're like, I want to make it so that like you're coming around the corner and you hear this weird sound, and you're like, what the hell is that? And then you round the corner, you see this shadow projected on the wall. And I would describe sequences, and she'd be like, oh, what if you did this? And we'd bounce ideas off each other. And eventually I'd show her some video, or I'd take her into the studio to review it. And she would do the same thing with her story. She'd be writing one of her novels, and I would sort of help edit or give feedback and that sort of thing. So we've always collaborated. And when the idea for Perception hit me, the first thing I thought was like, this is our chance to work together, because we were both kind of in between different things. You know, she was had just finished up teaching to focus on raising the family, but we thought there was an opportunity to collaborate on this game, and so had to take it, right? You know, I was lucky to be at Irrational. I mean, a lot of ways it was like going to a college every day. You know, you're working with some of the most brilliant people in the industry in every capacity. You know, if you talk about, you know, on the marketing side, or you talk about on the art side, programming, you know, people like Chris Klein, the lead programmer on BioShock, the way that everyone, you know, we were hitting way outside of our weight class at Irrational. I think everyone there was, you know, just as passionate as I was, in some cases more so, about games and making games and the sort of magic that I talked about. But yeah, I don't know that you can make a game like BioShock unless you have that kind of crew. I think that one of the truths that's universal in game development is that, you know, there's always opportunity. I think it's really about doing everything you can to look for those opportunities and to capitalize on them. And I was at the right place at the right time, so that's certainly part of it. I came on to work on a game called The Lost, which was an ill-fated game for PS2 that was, we kind of internally talked about it being, it's like Zelda meets Silent Hill. And so it was like an action RPG, third person, and you could play as all these different characters. You could play, basically, you're absorbing these souls of these characters in hell, and then you can transform into them. Yeah, nobody's heard of it, right? But there's a lot of promise there, but there were a lot of limitations. There were a lot of constraints that we couldn't overcome, both technical and design, and there was a lot of, it was a challenge project. And I think that, you know, it was probably too ambitious for its time and for the platform. And so I came on to do QA on it, and I learned a ton. And it was an interesting time because, you know, we were committed to finishing the project, but, you know, we were having all kinds of technical issues, but then also issues with our publisher and things like that. And so a lot of the team sort of was rolling off to go work on other things and early pitches for BioShock, like the very first version, which was like a bunch of Nazis on a desert island tropical island. It was, yeah, completely different. We've talked about that history quite a bit. But, you know, so I was able to, as the team rolled off, there were bugs that I was finding. And there wasn't a whole lot of people to address them. And sometimes there were lower level, like, well, we could fix this, but we have limited, you know, hours and that sort of thing. And so I would offer the designer of the project, was like, hey, you know, I've been learning Unreal. Do you mind if I fix some of these? And he was like, please, just you. I'm swamped, so you go ahead and take care of that. And at the same time, you know, I was lucky enough to be able to give the be given the opportunities where people would listen. I think that was one of the keys there as well to Irrational, was that everyone there was curious and they were interested in not just their tiny little niche of responsibility, but they're interested in all aspects of the game and to trying to make all aspects of the game better. And I think everyone had that realization that you don't do that. You don't make a better game. You don't make a game like BioShock without that openness and willingness to admit, hey, could this be better? Of course. You're never going to get it right in games. You're always going to be wrong. It's a question of to what degree you're going to be wrong. If it's wrong a tiny bit, then great, people will love it. That sounds really pessimistic, but it's the truth, because I don't believe, you know, games are ever done. I don't believe games are ever perfect. I think it's you find that sweet spot that feels just right, and the mouthfeel, where whether it's the controls or the story, you know, you tweak it till it sort of finds that happy place, that the perfect balance, you know. I don't even know what it's called, but when Irrational essentially, you know, shrunk or closed or whatever, so it was a surprise. You know, there was a lot of odd apprehension in the air for a while, because, you know, it was like, what's next? And, you know, the team had grown, like, I think a lot more than any of us expected at first. Like, you know, to get a project like BioShock Infinite to completion, you know, that was a tremendous effort. And I think it took its toll. I think, you know, a lot of people were just like pretty fried. And so it was definitely time for a change. You know, I think that a lot of us knew it, even though some of us didn't necessarily see it coming. It was a surprise for a lot of people.
We were really surprised. I mean, because Bill was, you know, he was the lead designer on BioShock, lead level designer on Infinite, and I thought that, you know, if some people were going to be saved, it was going to be him. So, I mean, it was a big surprise. But, you know, I mean, when something bad happens, you take a lesson away from it, and basically now Bill is on his own and he can do his own projects, and, you know, now we have Perception, and he was able to spend the most formative years of his children's lives at home, you know, and what's better than that?
You know, it's the kind of thing I never would have left, you know? I love the people and I love the stuff that we worked on. You know, it was a tough project for sure, but it was too much fun working with those people. And so I went back to school, and that's where in the program, the UX program at Bentley University, the initial seed of the idea for Perception came to me one night when I was taking a prototyping class. And the professor, who's an absolute legend in UX circles, his name's Chauncey, at the end of class one night, he just offhandedly says, "Oh, by the time you all get to your cars tonight, you're all going to think of a brilliant idea." And it's, you know, it's silly, but I eat that sort of thing up. I love those kind of challenges. I love to sort of get the mind going. And so Amanda and I had, you know, we're always talking about different ideas for games, but, you know, specifically high concepts for horror games. And so I'm walking to my car and I'm saying, okay, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna think of the next big idea, right? And so I'm walking and it's a cold October night. It's dark out. And it's probably 10 o'clock at night. And I'm walking to my car and one of the lights in the parking lot is out. And so there's like pine needles on the ground everywhere, leaves. And it's cold enough that I know there could be ice. So I'm walking very carefully and it gets really, really dark. And I'm approaching my car and I'm like, horror games. What if you played as a blind person in a horror game? What, you know, information is the enemy of horror. And so what if we could take the information you rely on the most, the visuals, and turn that into the core of the game, you know, where you can't see? And so I start running through my head, and I'm getting really excited. I'm like, oh my God, that's a great idea. I have to make that happen. So I immediately call Amanda, and I'm like, what if you were a blind person in a haunted mansion? And she's like, what? What do you mean? It's like, what, it's a horror game, but you're playing as a blind person. And she's like, oh my God, okay. Oh my God, yeah.
I got this frantic phone call from him on the way home from class one night about like echolocation and blind. I'm like, whoa, buddy, slow down. What's going on? And then when he got home, you know, my author mind clicked in and we just started riffing off each other and ideas, and pretty much perception was born that night. And then it almost wasn't even a conversation of like, are we doing this? Like, just like, okay. He was like, okay, I'm gonna call Jim tomorrow, like Jim Bonney. And maybe we'll kickstart it. Maybe we'll, I don't know, we'll figure it out. And like, we just move forward without even having the, is this a good choice? Is this what's best for our family? Like, it was just like, no, we're doing this. So we did it.
I didn't plan on starting a company. I didn't plan on building a game. But sometimes you're hit with something, you have to make it happen. And that's what this project was. It was like this inexorable pull to build this thing. Without a rational, that wouldn't be possible, obviously. It's, you know, Ken took me under his wing. He showed me everything he showed me quite a bit, right? And I'm incredibly grateful for that and for my time there. And, you know, again, I don't think perception would have been wouldn't have happened if not for Irrational, so.
It was almost like immediately where Bill started calling the team together, like, okay, I'm gonna get in touch with Rob Waters, you know, for concepting the art. I'm definitely calling, like, Jim Bonney was almost like middle of the night kind of call. Like, we called him immediately the next day. And yeah, we got our friend from Irrational, Justin Sonicalb, to put together a prototype. It's really early, and my voice, like, I actually do the voice in it, and it is pathetic. I sound like Beavis from Beavis and Butthead. It's pretty bad.
Start from the bottom and work my way up. Yeah, sounds like a plan.
But it gives you a good idea of like, okay, tap, here's the echolocation, tap, you know. So you essentially start to see it getting put together. And from there, you know, we just started with putting together the Kickstarter campaign. It just all started to happen. And there was no stopping. Once we were at that point, we're like, all right, we're doing this, and that's that.
The pieces started to come together, and I came in thinking like, this is something, hey, I'm just gonna prototype. And I think I was tricking myself into building up enough of the game where I could say, you know what, I have to do this. And sure enough, at one point, Amanda came to me and she was like, you know, we've been working on this for like 3 months now, and you've got some side gigs going on or whatever, but we need to, you know, pull the trigger on this. We decided, yeah, it was time to make it, we gotta go public with this thing. We need some pressure. We need to get it out there, to give us some deadlines and to give us some real goals. And so we decided, you know what, we'll give ourselves 3 more months, launch a Kickstarter, and if all goes well, we're in this thing, right? And so we started building towards some trailers, concepting, you know, what would be a good way to encapsulate the experience of what it's like to be at Echo Bluff and to be, you know, to play as Cassie, to use echolocation to see. And so we felt the best approach would be from the very beginning of the game, experiencing that approach to Echo Bluff, that foreboding buildup of walking up to this abandoned mansion. You've no idea what's inside, you know. All you know is that you've been tormented by these nightmares and that the house has been calling to you. I mean, you were talking about stakes. You know, we had invested at that point, you know, about 6 months of development, all out of pocket, and, you know, so it's tremendous risk, especially where, you know, we were, Amanda was pregnant, 8 months pregnant with Ronan at the time, and so there was a lot riding on it. You know, I was lucky enough to have, again, a lot of friends come in and help with the project and just sort of do it on spec, just do it on, like, the potential of eventually getting paid, or maybe not. And so, you know, there's a lot riding on it, of course. Every Kickstarter experiences that, I'm sure. But there's something really powerful about being able to get your vision out there from the get-go so people understand what you're trying to build. Something really raw and honest about that.
We sort of knew we had a number of options, but none of them seemed as appealing as Kickstarter. And, you know, we really loved that we'd be getting a community from the beginning. And we went into the Kickstarter not really planning on doing physical copies. And there was a need, and there was a want, and so we're like, okay, we're doing physical copies, you know? And so a Kickstarter, like, speaking of, a game is a living document, you know, Kickstarter is a living thing. And it grew, and we adapted. And it was a really cool experience. It was super stressful. I was like 8 months pregnant, and I was also teaching. So it was like, I'm doing this lesson. Oh my God, I'm having fake contractions. Oh my God, I'm checking the Kickstarter. It was like, it was so stressful. I mean, but like, stress has been the name of the game, man. Like, that's just, you know, part of the job, part of how this all went.
I'm really glad we went to Kickstarter because it was a constant source of feedback and inspiration and support. And you know, we've been very lucky to have the kind of stuff. We couldn't build this game without, you know, our family, you know, without people helping out with the kids, without you know, my parents to come by when I'm passed out at my desk to give me a coffee, and you know, Amanda's mother, Nancy, to come by and watch the kids and all of that. But then also to be able to go to some of the people I worked with before, like Forrest Dowling from the Molasses Flood. You know, people I could lean on, and people I've worked with in the past, and say like, "Hey, we're having trouble with this messaging," or "How do you go about approaching a PS4 version?" So it's been a learning experience, and I think that for me, again, it's just really about surrounding yourself with the right people. When we were hit with the idea of playing as a blind person, somebody who uses echolocation, you know, I viewed it as critical to try and make sure that we got that right, and to make sure that we were, you know, it was very clear from the beginning that we weren't making a simulation, but I really wanted to capture that feeling of what it might be like to use echolocation.
Something that was absolutely critical to us is representation matters, and having a disabled protagonist, we do not want this to look like a superpower, okay? Echolocation is real, there are people who do it. We spent extensive researching echolocators, and you know, it was really, really fortunate. We got hooked up with World Access for the Blind, which is a charity that teaches blind people to echolocate, and it's headed by this man, Daniel Kish. And Daniel is our hero. He's amazing. Daniel Kish went blind as a toddler, and he learned to echolocate, and now he's the world's most foremost echolocator. He does a TED Talk on it, which I recommend everybody look up. It's absolutely fascinating.
He was fantastic in that not only was he inspirational, but he served as a good way to sort of, you know, check a lot of our assumptions and a lot of what we had learned. And, you know, just having dinner with him, just seeing how, if I'm being honest, you know, walking down the streets of Boston as he's echolocating, as he's using his white cane, and he's making his clicking sound to take in the environment. And, you know, if you've walked in Boston, you know how rough the streets can be. You know, there's one-ways all over the place, and there's cobblestone and brick that just, like, makes for pretty perilous walking, right? But he was hauling ass down the street. Like, I'm a fast walker, and he was, like, way ahead of it. And so Amanda and I went out for sushi with Daniel, and he was just, like, boom. I mean, he's aware of everything. You see, a power box coming up in the middle of the sidewalk, and you skirt right around it, no problem. And so that was fascinating to me, and it gave me further courage to say, like, that I think this is something really special. I think that this is an opportunity for a game to show a different perspective, and that's why it's called Perception. is that, you know, it's meant to challenge the way that we see things and make the player and Cassie challenge what they're experiencing and what they're perceiving.
I mean, at its heart, perception is about the judgment of marginalized people, women, the disabled. Like, if you go through every level, you see these things happening. And really, the message at the end of the game is like, don't judge. And, you know, you are capable of so much more. And if you've ever been told no, this is for you, or been told you can't do something, this is for you. And we were really passionate about that. And we really hope that when people play the game, they get that sort of, you know, feeling.
You know, the idea, the backstory behind Perception was something that, you know, Amanda and I had discussed very early on, and we knew that we wanted to, you know, to tap into a little of my family history. And so going back to, you know, I was, I don't know, maybe 10 years old when my grandmother first told me about Susanna Martin.
Men wanted her land and she was a defenseless widow. And it's like, how exploitative can you get? This poor old woman. So she was accused 4 times in her life, this poor woman. And she just had this sweet spot of land. And so people were like, yeah, she's a witch, totally a witch, get her. And they humiliated her. If you read the trial of Susanna Martin, it is just shameful. And we really thought that this could make such an amazing game by pairing it with the story of Cassie and making it a generational saga.
That was something that I really wanted to tell as a story. And so Amanda and I worked out the details of how that might go down. We thought it was a really natural fit for Cassie's arc and for Cassie's realization and sort of like her own growth as a character and realizing her own family ties. It's very much, there are a lot of similarities to what, you know, sort of when I realized my own connection there.
We went to 2 places mainly for the inspiration of Echo Bluff, and they were the Corwin House, which is known as the Witch House, and Nathaniel Hawthorne's The House of Seven Gables. So as an English teacher, Nathaniel Hawthorne, it's like, oh my God, this is so exciting. And we did use some references from Young Goodman Brown in the game, so if anybody's a literary nerd, they will catch that. But so the Corwin House, the Witch House, is the brown one in the video that we went to. It was the second house that we went to. And it had a lot of the shapes and sort of the architecture that we really liked. And inside the house were these little, like, voodoo-ish dolls. They were called poppets. And we were like, we are so using those. Now, so obviously they weren't like the Victorian dolls we used, but they were like the little ones that you find in each level. We took pictures. We were like, this is what we're basing that little bit of mythology on. And in a lot of the rooms, we got ideas of how they would look and the heights and sort of the decor. And we got a lot of ideas from that. And then we went to the House of Seven Gables and saw Nathaniel Hawthorne's whole compound. I mean, like, there was a carriage house, an accounting house, and, you know, we really, that's where we got the idea of Echo Bluff almost like as a campus, you know. So you would have the garage separate, you would have a shed separate, you would have the dock. So you really had like all of these different parts of Echo Bluff that we were really inspired by.
That was hugely enriching. I think the game is a lot better for it, that being right there, and all the times we've, you know, made the trip to the House of Seven Gables or just walking around downtown Salem, you know, just getting in touch with all of the little stories about the witch trials. And not only Susanna's story, but, you know, Rebecca Nurse and talking about, you know, how everything went down and then how to get that across and sort of a lot of the guilt that is associated with. And that's the point of a character like Faith, where you have, you know, this counterpoint to this religious zealot character who's, you know, completely steadfast in firm belief that he's doing the right thing. He's tricked himself into thinking that this is God's will in taking this land. I'm claiming it in the name of God. And that sort of zealotry and how belief can turn someone to do great evil. A lot of that touches into the guilt that Corwin, the judge who presided over the witch trials, the guilt that he felt. And then Hawthorne, one of the descendants who wrote the Scarlet Letter, the guilt that he felt. And that was part of the reason he wrote the Scarlet Letter. Just trying to tap into a lot of those interesting side stories and to hopefully seed those pieces into the story of Perception. So when people go through, and they get the little nudges, and they go through it again, and they start to make more sense of it. And I'll play people talk about it some, and you know, shed a little light on this dark period of history.
when you put out a story, you release it into the world, and then people interpret it and do their thing from there. You know, I'm not the type who says, like, the story exists solely in my head. Like, it's for people to experience and interpret, and that's cool. You know, it was kind of baffling for us to see, you know, really high reviews and also incredibly low reviews that said sort of opposite things.
So when some of the reviews came out, it was a little bit like, what the hell just happened? You know, it was a serious punch in the gut. And I think that there was a lot of very good feedback, very useful feedback that we're channeling into the remaster, which will be out very soon. So that stuff's helpful. I'm always open for constructive feedback and criticism, and you know, it's how you make a better game. It's how you become a better developer. I think a little bit of it was, you know, frankly toxic and like a little bit like odd posturing, and not to sound like, oh, I'm like, you know, bitter about it or whatever, but you know, I think where it's just when you say something like, oh, you know, boring or whatever, like what do you do with that?
We sort of realized that people really only saw like BioShock and horror, and a lot of the reviews were like, this is disappointing because it's not BioShock. Well, guess what? We had about tens of millions of less dollars to do it, and we made this in our basement. And I think that that's what's great about this documentary, is it's showing like, yeah, this wasn't like a studio. This is like a married couple chasing their four kids, making a game, like making their dreams happen. And we really learned our lesson that people have a pretty narrow definition of horror. We really think of this more as a, we're now realizing this is more of a thriller, and it's more of like a tense psychological narrative. And people define horror as like jump scares and really gory. And like, we don't really have either of those, but we still feel like it's very much like The Shining, like that anxiety, that tension, that angst that sort of haunts you.
I'm always gonna listen to feedback when someone says, like, you know, some of it was, the checkpoints are pretty punishing in the game. It's like, I wish we had caught that. But I 100% agree, and so we went and changed that, you know? We added new modes, because it's interesting because some people were like, oh, you know, I love the story. I wish I could just focus on the story and actually play it as a walking sim or a ghost story. And some people are like, I wish there was more of a challenge, and I wish that there was more, you know, of a threat. And so, you know, these were ideas that we had tried to balance, and we had played around with actually adding in modes before we had shipped, and I wish we had, but we're adding them in now.
We just want the game to be accessible to more people. Like, more people, more different types of gamers can enjoy it now. So I actually see it as a positive. I know that's hard to say. But also, the user reviews are super high. Like, on Steam, like, our reviews are, like, in the 90s. So, I mean, people are enjoying it. Like, the reviews, the critical reviews early on may have been, like, really polarizing. But, like, when you look at the user reviews, people are enjoying it. So we're really happy. And I think just more people are going to enjoy it because of the remaster. Working from home and making this whole family thing happen, like, you know, we take the good with the bad, and there were definitely points that were low points for us. I was 8 months pregnant with our third child, and man, that Kickstarter was stressful, and I was just out to here, and it was hot, and I was working like three jobs, and it was just like chaos, really stressful. But I have to say, then getting pregnant 4 months later with another one was also stressful. Did not see that coming. And after she was born, we hit a really, really stressful point in the game. So we'd been working with a funding partner for about 6 months. So we had people contracting. We were working with people because we were just working on this contract, ironing out the fine details of it. And right after I had my daughter, we were putting the finishing touches on one last clause, and they called us one morning and they pulled out. And you know, I was sitting there, I was down here, I was nursing my daughter when Bill got the call, and I mean, it was a lot of money, and we lost it all. They lost their entire funding. And we had been having people work for 6 months because this was happening. I had no words. Like, I was in such shock that I couldn't even form a sentence. And I looked to Bill, and I had tears in my eyes, and he pivoted like this. He was like, okay, here are our options. We could do this, 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 or this. And I'm like, I can't even form a sentence, and you can put together a plan for what's next. Like, I'm just so impressed with him. I'm continuously impressed with him. But being able to, like, pull us out of that, you know, within a few weeks, we really had genuine options. Things didn't quite pick up from there. We both got incredibly sick because we had been really pushing ourselves. He was pushing himself so hard during crunch that he got mono. He would have like his pillow at the desk, like he was so sick, but we had such stringent deadlines, like we had to make them. And nobody else is, like we have people contracting that we can do, but like most of the bulk of the stuff was him, so I mean he was as sick as a dog. And then I got it right during PAX and GDC, and here I am thinking, I was just run down because I was like, I'm just doing PAX and GDC and have four kids in a business, this is why I feel so horrible. And then I went to the doctor and she was like, oh honey, no. No, like you have mono, like you need to rest. I'm like, what's that? I don't even know what that means. So we're really, really lucky that we both have our families in the same town as us, and his parents, my mom, like sisters, brothers, like we had, you know, our families come in and help take care of us and help take care of the kids and still make the deadlines. So, I mean, we hit some lows, but like, what's more important than doing this for your family? Like, that's what we're about. We're about family and games and fun and like, there's nothing more important than that, so that's just what we did.
You know, it's funny because Perception was a game about my family, and it was built by family, and I don't know that it would have been possible without that. I want to be able to not feel like my family is, you know, somewhere else, and to feel more active and more of an active participant, and not have my kids grow up away from me. It's nice to me, the notion that it all comes back to that notion of family. You know, the people that I've worked with, people like Jim, I consider him family. You know, working with Amanda and all of the people, all the hands that weighed in to help make this happen when, in our darkest hours, when it seemed like it wasn't possible, when, you know, you have partners who back out at the last minute. Because you know they've lost their funding or whatever. When you have people who don't believe in your project, and you have a bad review, when you have technical issues, when you have everyone being sick, and like every hurdle that you come across, and to have people stand by you, you know, you have people weighing in on everything. So I'm very fortunate to have all the people behind me that I have to make Perception, and. I hope that, you know, as people get to play it, I hope we've done them right. I hope that, you know, I built something that makes them proud.
We did prototypes of how the presents should walk, and it's literally Bill with a like comforter like that goes on a bed, like a big quilt, stumbling around the hallways of this house. It is priceless, and we will show you the footage, and it'll make you a household name. It's that hilarious. And there are some that are me, and you can see because the presence is like tiny compared to like I'm just like fumbling around the house and trying to look scary, but like coming off drunk. Pretty amazing.
Ha ha ha!